I am here today with Kate Ekman, who is the author of a great new book called The Full Spirit Workout. And I'm going to read the subtitle because I think it's so cool. A 10-step system to shed your self-doubt, strengthen your spiritual core, and create a fun and fulfilling life. And who doesn't want a fun and fulfilling life? So welcome, Kate. Thanks for being here at Red Cape Revolution.
Thank you so much for having me. It's my joy to be here with you and your beautiful self and your beautiful flowers.
Thank you. We have to have a little bit of nature in the back. Actually, it matches your book cover, I think, right?
I love it. It's beautiful.
We'll say that we planned that, right? Yes. I think it's a beautiful book, by the way, too. But congratulations on the book.
Thank you so much.
It was really intriguing when we were introduced by a mutual friend, and you know, the idea of a workout, you know, we all talk about we have to work out. I don't work out as much as I should, but working out our spirit, you know, that inner part of us, no matter what our religious or, you know, beliefs are. So your book goes into a lot of things that I think are really resonant right now, especially as, you know, we move into a new world of work and into kind of through all the changes that have gone on. So I'd love to hear a little bit about how the book came about and, you know, and sort of the work that you're doing to help people get to their full spirit.
Right. So first of all, the spirit is not religious. The full spirit workout is a play on the full body workout that you often hear advertised at a gym, but your full spirit is your authentic truth and power. It's your passion. It's your presence. It's showing up like you mean it and you've got something to say and you're excited and enthusiastic about life or a project that you're working on. So when you think of spirit, think of your essence. It's the part of us that can't be overlooked or rejected or criticized. It really is the truth of who we are that we don't tap into because in our culture, so much emphasis is placed on the physical, you know, in terms of what we look like. We all know we need to exercise our physical muscles, but much, much, much less attention is paid to our attitudinal muscles, our mental, emotional, spiritual muscles, and really getting fit on the inside. And this applies to everyone because, you know, everyone wants to feel more confident in some area of their life. I work with a lot of clients who they don't need my help doing their job. They're quite skilled at their day-to-day tasks, whether it's, you know, a CEO of a Fortune 50 company, which I just got back from an offsite with that group, and he's good at doing his job. People need help with the less tangible roadblocks like stress and anxiety, fear, overwhelm, exhaustion, and they're not really quite sure where to go or where to start. And so that's why, you know, I've done the research and really have come up with a life resource tool and really the keys for a better way of living that applies to everyone, whether you're the stay-at-home mom, the CEO of your household, or, you know, you're running a multi-billion dollar company or you're somewhere in between. We all could use a brush up on these inner musculature skills.
Yeah, I love the, you know, what you said around that we're often really good at our jobs. But one of the things that you talk about in the book also is that, you know, people like the CEO you worked with, and like you've been a broadcast journalist and a model, and, you know, people would look at your life, people look at other, you know, the CEO's life and say, wow, they've got it made. I call that looking good on paper. But one of the things you talk about in the book, you know, with building some of these attitudinal muscles, you know, are just some of the doubts that creep in. So I'd love for you to tell us a little bit about how someone can overcome, you know, some of that. I call it the battle of the brain, but you've got some tools and strategies to be able to give those muscles a workout to help believe in yourself again.
Yeah, I think the self-doubt creeps in when we have those moments where we forget who we are, we fall asleep to our truth, and we forget just that we're powerful and we can do whatever we decide is important enough, whatever work we're willing to put in. You know, even I was watching, you know, the Olympics and the swim coach who has the athlete who says, I want to win a gold medal. And he says, you know, everyone wants that result. Everyone wants the gold medal, whatever your gold medal is. But then, and I say the same thing, just like when people tell me I want to write a book and I say, great, why do you want to write a book? And a lot of people don't have a strong why. It's maybe more of a vanity project and you can certainly do it, but you probably won't enjoy it. You might not have as good of a result. And the same with anything that we want to train for. It really is our willingness to show up and put in the work. Because when you show up and put in the work, your doubt starts to go away. The imposter that says, well, who are you to do this? It's like, I'm the person sitting here doing this. You can go take several seats. And so, you know, people think it's this big magical thing. How do I get rid of the anxiety and the insecurities? And so much of it is our willingness. Show up and not be great first or ever. That's me in dance class. I get so much confidence going to dance class though, because I'm like, wow, I'm really terrible at this practice and discipline, but I'm willing to show up. It's not about impressing anyone. It's about having fun. I think a lot of people really need to redefine success for themselves, because you can make all the money and have all the shiny objects, and research says that doesn't move the needle on your well-being. So what moves the needle is sleep and exercise, acts of kindness and service, time affluence, having the time to do what you actually want to do, social connection, what we're doing here, even over Zoom. And my favorite is a gratitude visit that I write about in the book. And so I think a lot of times when we're feeling stuck, overwhelmed, anxious, we're all caught up in our little world and ourselves. And I think when we can broaden our perspective and really look at things from a fresh new way and be other focused, all that crap just kind of melts away and fades away. Does that make sense?
Yeah, definitely. Well, and you tell the story in the book about going to dance class and just, you know, really, and you were a competitive swimmer. You were, you know, on the team at Penn State. You got your master's at Northwestern for journalism, you know, lots of big accomplishments, but going to something like a dance class, you know, the way you described it was, I mean, you didn't want to fail. You didn't want to look stupid. And I think that so many times people that I interact with, when they're at a decision point in their career or they have an opportunity to potentially raise their hand for something, it's, you know, the pulling back because we don't want to look stupid. We don't want to fail. But you give some strategies in the Full Spirit Workout about how, you know, I mean, there's never really failure, that really it's the action that comes before feeling confident, as opposed to the other way around, that you think you have to be confident before you take the action.
Yeah, I think one of the cornerstones of confidence is failing. And as my dance coach said to me, let's start with failure, which made me laugh. I'm like, well, fail in dance class, I can do. Even leadership development classes that I teach with organizations and workshops that we do, one of the major lessons is failing fast. And so again, our good intentions are not enough. Our willingness is everything. One of my favorite spiritual principles, and just your willingness and being willing to try something out. Okay, this doesn't work. What did you learn about yourself in the process? And then moving on to the next thing, but really getting in there, getting your hands dirty, trying stuff out. That's why step one of this book is stretch your comfort zone. And I think, you know, a lot of people are comfortable in their stress or their misery or their ain't it awful. And if you are willing to, you know, invest in a coach or, invest in any personal or professional development, not because you have problems, not because you're the worst, but because you're the best. And, you know, I was an athlete for so long. And so I speak in athletic terms a lot, but you think of a Tom Brady who's still winning Super Bowls in his 40s. He trains harder than anyone. He has more coaches than anyone, not because he's the worst, but because he's the best. Think about when you watch the Olympics, the NBA finals, the Super Bowl. There are like thousands and hundreds of coaches like up in the mix. Nobody, no matter how great you are, is out there without a coach. Think about it. And you're talking to the coach throughout the game, in between every play. So I want people to start realizing that this investment in yourself is so valuable and will really take you to the next level. But first, we have to acknowledge that we don't know it all, and that we're willing to try some different avenues or be open to new and fresh perspectives.
And you know, that investment in yourself, again, back to, I think, the point you made about less about being teach me the stuff. You know, I mean, Tom Brady, probably when he was 12, had a coach that helped him learn how to throw a football, but now he knows how to throw a football. It's, you know, how do you, you know, stay in tune with who you are and what you want, and how to, for him, I imagine it's, you know, managing through change and new teams and staying ahead of himself. And so many of the things in here I felt were really good. You had some great scripts for mindset shifts, which is something I talk about too in my upcoming book. You know, it's the what can you talk to, you know, how do you talk back to that little voice in your head? You know, how do you make sure that you're not dampening your spirits? I haven't really talked about it like spirit, but I think that's a great word for it. And bringing out, you know, your superpowers in a way that feels really unique and authentic to you. So,
yeah, I think a lot of times we're stuck in our anxious brain. And, you know, I talk about the research in the book where we can, you know, first we have to recognize that we're there, whether it's, oh, wow, I'm experiencing a lot of self-doubt or anxiety or insecurity at this moment. We first have to have the self-awareness to know like, oh, okay, I'm feeling some kind of funky way right now. And then, you know, shift out of that. So identify it and then move into something else, invite something else in. And a good way to do that quickly, two things. One is to move from the anxious brain into the curious brain. Start asking yourself different questions. Or even I had a moment where I was crying after this, getting actually my training at Columbia and coaching. And, you know, before the last session, I was experiencing a lot of emotion. And instead of judging myself or be like, oh my gosh, you can't cry in front of people, I moved from the anxiety into curiosity and thought, I got curious about my emotion and thought, what is this about? And what it was about is that these people meant so much to me. This opportunity, this training was so life-changing that was a completely normal response. I think so many times we judge ourselves for whatever we're experiencing. And so I invite you to get a little bit more curious about your emotions or about these thought patterns that you're constantly having. It's like, oh, it's you again. Even me, I talk about calling out my inner critic, like, oh, okay, I see you, you know, you can go sit back down. But it's like, well, what does she want me to know here? Or what is she trying to do? And so whatever you do in the past, like, oh, I'm anxious, I'm freaking out. Oh, it's okay, this time I'm gonna try something new. I'm not gonna freak out at all. I'm gonna get up there and trust that whatever I need to say to this group or organization or audience is what they need to hear, and trust in my training. I think we all have worked so hard at this point. Trust in that hard work. And then when you show up, whether it's the job interview or the presentation or whatever it is, really focus on being present, being all there. And again, showing up like you mean it, because presence is my first P of the five P's of confidence. And when I'm present, that's all I'm thinking about. And then you're in the flow, you get in the zone, and you're not worried if someone likes you or how good do I sound, because you're just present with what you're doing and who you're talking to. And trust in that.
Right. And the idea of being able to be present to me also goes back to that feeling of I'm not going to fail. Like showing up is the battle. And so many times that really is it. You know, I think we forget that everybody else is making it up too, right? That there is no perfect presentation. There is no perfect meeting. There's no perfect job interview or there's no such thing as perfect, but we can make progress. We can try different things. We can experiment with different techniques in here. And one of the things that I thought was fun that you did is really to equate it to things that we talk about when we're talking about building our physical bodies, you know, core strength and, you know, being able to just build those different muscles. So I thought that, you know, for anybody where the idea of kind of getting in touch with your spirit feels a little woo woo, well, you wouldn't feel that way about going to the gym or, you know, building your muscles. So these are important muscles that I think we get overlooked quite a bit.
But I think even just getting caught up in the spirit, because again, your spirit is just the truth of who you are, which a lot of people are out of touch with. This is about building your attitudinal muscles. That's your mental and emotional muscles. These are the muscles you're using all the time that quite frankly are a little flabby, are a little out of shape, because you're just going to the default setting. You're doing what's comfortable. You haven't trained and worked them out in a meaningful way for whatever reason, whether it's fear or I don't even know how to do it. We need to just start having these conversations a little bit more openly and be willing to go within. And that's really what I mean too. It's taking a moment to go within, because all the stuff you want that's going to help you get from point A to point B, I hate to tell you, but it's not out there. It's in here. It's taking the moment. Why do you think meditation is so popular? A lot of people don't take advantage of this proven practice for whatever reason, in the spirit of, I don't have time, for instance. And to that I say, I don't have time to be angry. I don't have time to be stressed out. I don't have time to be overwhelmed. I don't have time to raise my voice with the people I care about. I don't have time to not actualize my full potential because I'm spending all my time stuck in the, ain't it awful? I can't do this. Only those people can do it. Whatever. Everyone, I think, knows what I'm talking about. And we've all been there, by the way. That's why I recognize it, because I've certainly been there. But I think this is just opening ourselves up to so many opportunities. And a practice that has really saved me during the past year and a half, a year and a half of COVID, the era of COVID, is what I call my sit and stare time, where I take minimum 5 minutes a day and stare out the window and process and reflect and check in with myself like I'm a little kid, and just say, how are you doing? What can I do for you? What do you need right now? And also acknowledging myself, hey, good job. You handled that really upsetting email with so much grace and compassion. You didn't lose your cool, or great job closing that deal. Because we get so upset when others don't acknowledge us. But if we're really honest, I think we spend such a small fraction of time acknowledging and seeing and hearing ourselves.
That's so true. That's great advice. And so Kate, I want to acknowledge you. I think the book is fun and gives us really some insights and some scripts. Where can people find out more about you?
Sure. You just go to kateekman.tv. It's kateekman.tv, or the fullspiritworkout.com. It has all the information about the book there. It's everywhere books are sold, in line, online and in stores. And we'd love to connect with you over there. We have a really great community, and it really is about uplifting and energizing, not just ourselves and our lives, but really all of the people around us.
That's great. And we could all use the uplifting and remembering to uplift ourselves. So I'm going to go do some sit and stare time pretty soon. So anyway, well, Kate Ekman, author of The Full Spirit Workout, go pick up a copy. Thank you so much for being here for our community at redcaperevolution.com. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much. And congratulations on your book as well.
Thank you. More to come. Bye.